Thank you. Good afternoon, all of you. First, thank you for the invitation again. Last year, I was a minister, and I was invited. This year, I'm not a minister, and I'm still invited. So Singapore is a real friend. You see, being in Thai politics is really very unstable. We often have a military government, so you cannot have a career being a minister, unlike in Singapore, where you can be minister for everyone. I am going to talk about ASEAN economic community, and the intention is to inform you about this ASEAN economic community, about the work that we have done over the last 40-50 years. A lot of work has been done to create ASEAN of today, the ASEAN that we have. And I sincerely believe that without ASEAN, we would be faced with so many problems, as mentioned by the Deputy Prime Minister last night. The fragility, the power factors, technology and productivity, and sectoral problems and so on. So for us, now I belong to an asset management company. I always think of net asset value. So for us, ASEAN is a net asset value positive, meaning being more asset than liability. So we should be very pleased with that. And that is actually the conclusion of my speech. And if you have already heard the conclusion, you don't need to listen to anything else. But if you like to listen, let me continue. I like to tell this ASEAN economic community in a story manner, like a story telling, because you had such a serious session this morning. I was sitting there looking at the faces of you and feeling very worried about what was going on. So I changed my presentation from reading a speech to tell a story. And that story I would like to dedicate to Mr. Rajaratnam, the foundation name, and Dr. Kanil Sandhu. Why do I do that? It will be clear when I make the presentation. I would tell my story in six episodes. One episode less than Star Wars. You might recall that the latest Star Wars episode 7, the title is The Force Awakens. And listening to the session this morning, I was wondering, what was that force? Who was that Darth Vader? And if you look at Chinese history, the armor design, I was told that George Lucas copied the design of the dress, the costume of Darth Vader from China. So maybe that force in China, is it? You may wonder. But I leave that to your imagination. Now, beginning with the episode number one, six episodes, average maximum 5 minutes each. I guarantee that I will keep my time. I have been practicing that for so many years, and Singaporeans know my time. First is the beginning to be interested in Southeast Asia as a region. Why did I become to be interested? To be interested in Southeast Asia as a region. That went way back to my student day in Australia in 1966. That was the first time that I met Southeast Asian friends. And the one that I would like to mention the name, I'm very proud of him, is Dr. Budi Unoro, who was my classmate. He was vice president in the last government of Indonesia. I also have many other friends. Malaysia, the Chinese, Singapore, Sudan, became chief of the public housing authority, and many others, both men and women, boys and girls. And I like them very much. We got along very well. And one thing that I remember during my student day was the time that Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew went to Western Australia in 1966. I still remember. I don't know why I remember that. He gave a speech at the dining hall. It was packed with audience. And he spoke so well. I was so amazed how a person who speaks so well. Since then, I never fought him. And he would not let me forget him forever. So that was the time, you know, when he talked about the situation in Southeast Asia. And you remember, 1965 was a very crucial year for Southeast Asia. Singapore became independent from Malaysia. Indonesia came over from Sukarno. The period 1965 to Suharto. And there was the Tonkin incident in Vietnam. That was the beginning of the end of the superpower control on Indochina. You might recall the Tonkin incident about the U.S. Navy shooting the Vietnamese Navy and vice versa. And when President Lyndon Johnson was asked what happened, he said the U.S. Navy was shooting at the U.S., not at the Vietnamese Navy. And he was supposed to laugh and joke. And now, 1967, I came back to Thailand, teaching at Akrasanee University, and that was when the ASEAN was set up in Bangkok. Called the name Dr. Thanan Poman, Mr. Ratchasarana Mokos, Adam Malik, Turasa, Mr. Masiwa Ramos. So these were the people who set up ASEAN, I think basically to counter the threat of communism. And that was the first time that we, all of us in Asia, in Asia, learned about ASEAN, about its evolution from CITO, from ASA to Mapillion. Next, episode number two. Developing the support for AEC. That was from 1980. I was organizing a number of training programs for ASEAN officials with the support of UNDP. Then suddenly, for our foundation wanted to set up an ASEAN research unit. That was in 1982. So I was heavily trying to identify what agency should be best to set up that center. And we decided on ICS, Institute of Southeast Asian Studies. We set up the ASEAN Economic Research Unit with the leadership of Dr. Colonel Sattu. And that, what happened after that, is unbelievable. ICS or the Air Room produced a community of researchers and publications on ASEAN economic cooperation and ASEAN community. That was the birth of the so-called ASEAN economic mafia. Dr. Chesui, Dr. Hanis Sastro, Dr. Mohamed Ari, Dr. Kori Nakuro, etc., etc. I could also mention Ambassador Chachin. But she does not look like a mafia, so I have to excuse her for that. Listen. Then in 1984, I worked for the ASEAN Task Force that was set up in 1982, led by Anand Mandalachun. Many of you remember the name Anand Mandalachun. I come back to his name again. The task was set up to develop ASEAN economic community. After the oil crisis of 1979-1980, we produced a report in 1984, which became a blueprint for AEC, became a blueprint for AEC. Now, going to my last episode, let me just find my episode. I have to ask John Lucas what happened. I want to talk about the episode number three. The thing that happened in during the period of 1970s, We had ASEAN Summit for the first time, and that was following the end of the second, following the end of the Vietnamese War of 1975. And we had a summit in Bali, but nothing much came out of it. So from then on, we started to develop the episode that I mentioned, episode number two. Now, developing the support for AEC that I talked about, the episode number three, researching that I mentioned. Now, going on to the birth of AEC. The birth of AEC, like move very quickly to episode number four at 5 and 6, because I think this will be important for our discussion. The birth of AEC, as I mentioned before, we finished that report. But after 1985, after the Plaza Accord, the ASEAN economy was doing very well. So we did not pay that much attention to ASEAN. Until 1991, this is episode number four. This is the most crucial part. In 1991, something happened in Thailand. We had a coup d'etat. You may not be surprised at all, because Thailand always has a coup d'etat. But this one is important. This one was number 7, if we only counted the successful one. If you also counted the unsuccessful one, I think it was about number 17. So we pretty good at a coup d'etat, you know, and if the U.S. Army would like to have help from the Thai Army, if Donald Trump became president, we can definitely help. But my point is this. Sometimes in life, history, there's a lot of coincidence. The generals, the coup d'etat, they armed Narongchai prime minister. The one who was the head of the task force. He was so surprised that they asked him to be prime minister. But he accepted it. Usually, when you invite them to be prime minister, you don't say no. And especially, by the generals. He became prime minister in February 1991. In July, you know what happened? Prime minister of Singapore, Ho Chi Minh, went to see Narongchai and decided on setting up ASEAN refit area. They had a conversation and they decided to push for ASEAN refit area. This is what Singapore went with us. You know, in ASEAN, Singapore is the one that does the plotting, the scheming, and then grabbing the opportunity when it's open. Very good, you know. Somebody asked earlier what Singapore should do. They should continue to do that. So by September 1991 to February 1992, we won NAFTA by political economy approach. We studied political economy, we learned what would be easy, where would be easy, what where would be difficult. Singapore, of course, easy. We talked to Lee Hsien Loong, of course. He said, no need to discuss. We went to see Dr. Rafida, Narongchai, okay, no need to discuss. We spent 3 days in Indonesia. And 3 days in Indonesia, because he knew the difficult. I was the chief negotiator. You know, when I made the presentation, that time my counterpart was Pak Hartarto. And he's a very quiet man. After I finished, he said, Indonesia, no free trade. That's how he talked like somebody in the film, no free trade. So we continued to work on Indonesia. Narongchai sent somebody, give massage to Suharto and all this. 5 October, he came to Kuala Lumpur. We had an economic minister meeting. I made my presentation. Everyone was quiet. Dr. Rafida Chan, the chairperson, asked Pak Hartarto, Pak Hartarto, what's the Indonesian plan? This is how Dr. Rafida talks. Very much. The rapid feedback. And everyone was quiet. Then Pak Hartarto said, Indonesia agree. lesson number two here. Lesson number one, need Singapore to do the scheme plotting. Lesson number two, need Indonesia agreeing. No ASEAN agreement without Indonesia agreement. So that's lesson number two. That was the time we decided for ASTA. And ASTA was right here in this hotel, in this room, right? So what was the name? He was a minister of foreign affairs. He gave me tourist support, as you remember. We signed the ASTA agreement within 6 months we signed. It was the toughest negotiation ever in international affairs. Whenever somebody argues, I say, after a stand for agree first, talk after. So why they argue the most in Philippines? Because in the Philippines, they have a lot of lawyers, a lot of women lawyers. A lot of. And lawyers always argue, particularly women lawyers. So now, beginning of this ASEAN Economic Cooperation turning into ASEAN Economic Community. Later on, we had other countries joining ASEAN in 1995, Vietnam, 1997, Myanmar, PDR, 1999, Cambodia, and so on. And in 1997, I'd like to mention here also, very important, that the GMS, the Greater American Sub-Region, began to be an important part of ASEAN development. So we have, at that time, the emergence of mainland and maritime ASEAN because of the inclusion of the so-called CRME countries and because that allows the connectivity with the southern part of China. Now, episode number five, AEC and ASEAN development. I really believe because of ASTA allows ASEAN economy to be more open and more market-friendly. So from 2001, we experienced and observed the proliferation of FTAs. So many FTAs after 2001, particularly after ASEAN China. ASEAN China, ASEAN Japan, and when you agree, China must agree with Japan. Japan comes running very quickly after China. ASEAN Korea, ASEAN Australia, New Zealand, etc., etc. In addition, each ASEAN country has FTAs. And you know which country has the most FTAs? Singapore. Singapore has an FTA more than anybody. So much so that Hong Kong, another friend of mine, he said Singapore is the most promiscuous. I could not believe Singapore could be promiscuous. I believe the government will never allow Singapore to be promiscuous. But anyway, that's what happened. Then afterwards, we have agreements on trade and services, agreement on investment, agreement on working of the professionals, and so on. But all along, what we maintain is ASEAN open regionalism. By 2008, we have ASEAN Charter. By 2015, we have ASEAN Community, including economic, social, cultural, and security. Now, episode 6. The ASEAN economy into the future. I think it is of important part of this seminar. AEC from 2016. What would happen? Just 2 weeks ago, the government, the ASEAN government, they had a meeting to make an assessment about the 2015 blueprint. And the conclusion that was on the 22nd of March, in Chiang Mai, Thailand. The conclusion was that only about 70-75% of the list on the blueprint were accomplished. Now they set up the 2025 blueprint. My belief, we should not expect much from the blueprint. We should let the AAC, ASEAN community, and ASEAN economic community evolve by themselves. Why do I say that? I have both economic reasons and political reasons, and these are the things that we can discuss. Economics. Number one population. With ASEAN community, we now have 625 million people, compared with 520 in the year 2000. So in 15 years, we have increased population by 400 million, thanks mainly to the knows. They don't even know they know how to make babies. Unlike in Thailand and Singaporean, they forgot how to make babies. GDP. You heard this morning about India having GDP of 2.2 trillion. Us, 2.5 trillion. Went up from 0.6 trillion of the year 2000. This is a big economy. 604 million, more than 2.5 trillion GDP. And in China, it is 25% for merchandise, 80% for services, and we have urbanization. Over the last 15 years, I have been traveling all over the place. What I have seen, urbanization. Thailand is now passing 50%. Philippines following closely. And other countries also following and coming up. So ASEAN economy, much more advanced in the last decade and a half. You know what? We benefit so much from the opening of China-India. Of course, we arranged the so-called market-friendly policy to ASEAN. Then China-India opened. China, of course, opened earlier than India. India opened from 1991. I remember because I was in Delhi on the day that they finished the budget. They were selling the budget on the street. In Thailand, and keep it free, nobody buys. In India, they were selling budget. I asked, you know, I asked Shabaram, why? He said, because the reform is in the budget. So it's real from 1991. And what happened is, the entry of China and India, and I said it all over the place, when I explained the so-called global economy. It is like suddenly you have two huge labor forces entering the economy together more than one. Maybe a million workforce. And they are of different character. The Chinese are very hardworking people. You know, so they become factory of the world. The Indians, they are very hardworking people. They become hospital of the world. So you have the labor force in the factory, you have the labor force in the transaction. Internet transaction reduced drastically. This is so true, you know, in Thailand, we would never compete with the Chinese. We would never argue with India. Because we know we would never win. So we go along collaborating with them, and we want to further. That's how we do. So at the moment, according to my own assessment and my study, economies in ASEAN is much more regional and extra regional than before. Because of the open regionalism. Regional and extra-regional. In fact, many of the Thai corporations, they are making more money investing in other ASEAN countries than in Thailand. You have Thai corporations, Singapore corporations, Malaysian corporations, all over the place. The second reason is because that I don't want to push too hard on ASEAN schemes and things, because of politics, because of internal politics. We do not have enough strong leadership for set scheme of regional cooperation. We could not come up with a scheme and then get a political leadership push for it. Because the domestic politics is taking up a lot of time. Now, more than before, Thailand and Myanmar, look at these two countries. It's the politics of the ladies and generals. It's been ongoing for how many years? Formally, you look at Myanmar and monitor. And you say the politics is about how the generals treat the lady. And today you see how the lady treats the generals. Now in Thailand, a few years ago, you want to say how the lady treated the generals. Today, how the generals treat the lady. That is so preoccupying for them. They cannot agree on the constitution in Thailand today. We have written it maybe in 1919. And every constitution is so specific about certain achievement. And they, like in Myanmar, they try not to make to allow lady to be president. They could not put in the name Suu Kyi. So they say that anybody with foreign children not allowed to be president. So in Thailand, they argue about how to do that. Malaysia, look at Malaysia. That time when we had Malaysia under the Mahathir. now entangled among politics. Indonesia and the Philippines adjusting to government for popular representation. So, this domestic politics, I can go on and on, but I may offend too many people. In conclusion, I would say the following. The ASEAN economy has its own momentum now, with growing public recognition of ASEAN. Corporate sector is increasingly more regional and extra-regional. So all that we need is only more liberalization in investment and professional services that would allow corporations to optimize their operations. And any investment in infrastructure or connectivity is good for both domestic politics and regional economy. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.